There are so many things that call honeybee hives home. If you think about it, the hive is full of adult bees, it's full of larvae and pupae and eggs and wax and honey and pollen. All of these are potentially great resources of food for other critters. In this episode, I'm specifically going to talk about arthropod pests of honeybees, but not all arthropod pests, but really the minor arthropod pests that I feel you need to know about, that I need to calm some of your fears a bit and help you know how to deal with them if they need dealing with at all. So let me start with the word arthropod. That may not be a word that you use with frequency. Arthropod. Arthro means joint, pod means foot, so arthropod means jointed foot. Insects are arthropods. They have these jointed legs. Spiders are arthropods, mites are arthropods, etc. So within this group, arthropods, there's lots of things that impact bees. Of course, Varroa, small hive beetles, Tropilaelaps, Vespa velutina, all of these things are arthropods. But they're all going to get their own video because these are major arthropod threats to honeybees. This video is about minor arthropod threats to honeybees, and I'm just going to cover some broad categories for you. The first of those that I'll mention would be the flies. There are really three groups of flies that can cause problems for honeybees. The first of those groups are what I call the predator flies, of which one specific family of flies likes to feed upon honeybees. That specific family is what we call the robber flies. They are usually big, hairy, burly flies that don't really look like flies. When I say the word fly, you probably think house fly or little fruit fly or something like that. That's not what robber flies look like. They're big. The hairs on their legs are spiky. They're somewhat intimidating looking. And the reason they have these spiky hairs on their legs is they often capture their prey while flying. So there's a number of these types of flies that will capture honeybees, fly to an area, and you can see them at that area, maybe a tree branch, a fence post, etc., perched on that, feeding on a honeybee. In fact, those flies typically will catch the honeybees and fly back to the same area over and over and over. So if you look on the ground, you might actually see various carcasses of the prey of those robber flies going back maybe weeks and maybe even months, depending on the species of robber fly and the life expectancy. Another type of fly that people often think about when they think of honeybees is the group of flies that can parasitize or serve as parasitoids of honeybees. So one group of flies in particular would be flies from the group Phoridae. So this is a family of flies. This particular family of flies has a member that can get on a honeybee, lay an egg inside of it, the maggot hatched from that egg, and eat the honeybee alive from the inside. One of these particular species is actually the one they call the zombie fly, because the bee will die, its head might pop off as that fly now comes out of the body of the bee. It's got a really spooky name. If you look up on the internet, you'll see a lot about it. Its biology is kind of scary. The fact that it can lay eggs inside of a honeybee, eat the honeybee alive, and then pop off its head on the way out. Another type of fly that shows up on honeybee colonies would be the fly that most people don't even think is a fly, but it actually is, and that is the brolid. Often, if you look in the beekeeping literature, it's called the bee fly or the bee louse, with multiple members of this group called bee lice. They are neither a louse nor a lice. They are actually a true fly. The females are wingless and live on the backs of bees. And what it will do is when bees are feeding one another, it will come to the head where those two heads are interacting and exchanging honey, and it will feed from the honey being exchanged between the two bees. In fact, this fly with its front legs can tickle the mouth parts of bees and cause the bees to regurgitate honey, and it will sit there and feed. If you know where to look, you can see the bee louse commonly in a lot of countries around the world. Here in the U.S., where we're filming this particular series, I hardly ever see the bee louse. In fact, maybe I've never seen the bee louse in the U.S., and that's probably due to the fact that we put a lot of chemicals into our colonies to control Varroa, and this no doubt has an impact on the bee louse. On the other hand, when I go to countries that don't have a lot of chemical influence going into their colonies, I will often see the bee louse if I'm looking at bees in observation hives as an example. The bee louse really loves to hang out on queen honeybees because they are fed so frequently by the workers that the bee louse has just this steady smorgasbord of food available for them anytime they want to eat. So when I lived in South Africa, for example, and was watching bees in observation hive, I would routinely see queens that had 5 or 8 or 10 different bee louse individuals on the thoraces of these queens because they were wanting to be there and get fed. So the bee louse doesn't really cause any known effects in honeybee colonies to the bees themselves. However, the female bee louse, this female wingless fly, will lay eggs, and the maggots that come out of those will tunnel under the cappings of cells. So when you take out a frame of capped honey, you might see these zigzag lines across the cappings of the honey. That is often attributed to immature bee louse. And in this particular case, it's not causing any damage, it's just aesthetic damage. So this is not really something you'll need to treat against, it's just something you'll need to be mindful of if you're trying to make the perfect comb honey that you show on a honey show. So again, a quick fly overview. You've got these three kind of groups of flies. Flies that predate bees, they capture bees and eat them. That would be something like a robber fly. The second category would be the parasitoids or parasites of bees. And what they'll typically do is lay an egg on the bee or inside the bee, and it's immature, will eat the bee from the inside out and come out as an adult bee. I gave an example of a forage fly, but there are other species of flies that will develop fully in bees as well. And that third category would be the wingless fly, the brolid. And I will tell you, as scary as all three of these sound, none of them make measurable impacts on the bees. Yes, they can kill a few bees here and there. Yes, you've probably heard horror stories about the zombie flies causing the infested bees to fly to lights at nighttime and die of exposure. All of that's true, but they're unlikely to really cause significant damage to whole hives, to whole colonies in those hives, or to entire apiaries. So as we move away from flies, I'll bring to mind a few other arthropods that you might want to consider because you're probably going to see them at some point at your hives. The first of those would be beetles. Now, of course, honeybees are host to small hive beetles. That's a significant threat. It gets its own video. But other beetles also show up in honeybee colonies, and I'm going to focus on one specifically. The reason we call small hive beetles is because prior to their discovery, there was already a group of beetles showing up in honeybee colonies, and those beetles were large. Those beetles would go into honeybee hives, they'd go to the honey area or their pollen area in the nest, and they would eat the honey, they would eat the pollen, and the bees were seemingly unable to do anything to stop them. Because they are larger, they got the name large hive beetle. Subsequently, small hive beetles were smaller, so they got the name small hive beetle. But large hive beetle is really a huge umbrella term for essentially any scarab beetle that shows up in a hive. In the US, it would be a certain group of scarabs. In Africa, it would be a different group of scarabs. In Australia, yet again, a different group of scarabs. Scarabs is a large family of beetle that include many different members, some of which like nectar and pollen. They go to flowers to eat nectar and pollen. Honeybee hives are storehouses of nectar and pollen. So scarabs can go right in, bees can't attack them, and they'll go feed on the honey and pollen. I've seen dozens of these scarabs in a hive before, but never seen a hive collapse, a colony collapse, due to the feeding activity of scarabs. Again, it's scary, but it's not necessarily something that you need to address. So flies, beetles, and now bugs. And you've got to know, I'm an entomologist. All bugs are insects, but not all insects are bugs. There is a very special group of insects that are true bugs. Cicadas fall under this. Assassin bugs that I'm going to talk about fall under this. Bed bugs, stink bugs, these things all fall under the category of true bugs. Well, there is one group of true bugs, the assassin bugs, that are really, really, really good predators. They'll eat anything that comes their way. And these assassin bugs regardless of the species, might show up on the outside of one of your hives and be capturing honeybees at the nest entrance. Bugs, one of the uniting characteristics of all bugs is they have this very long needle-like mouth part. So when they capture the bees with their front legs, they unfold that needle-like mouth and stick it into the bees and suck out the juices. It's actually quite gruesome to watch. I've seen a particular species of assassin bug that we have here in Florida on my own hives. It's a huge bug. It's got bees in its mouth, and I see it all the time, and I go, oh my gosh, what is this doing? The answer is, it's eating a few bees, but your hives aren't going to die. Assassin bugs do this. You may see them. You don't really have to do anything to address it. Which brings me to my last category of arthropods. That would include the spiders. Spiders are going to hunt and eat your bees. It's perfectly okay that they do this. They might build a web between two of your hives and capture bees coming in and out. They might hang a web on a tree limb right outside the hive and capture a few of your bees every day and feed upon them. Spiders eat all sorts of arthropods. Your bees are arthropods. The honeybee hive is a smorgasbord of all of these bees. The spiders might decide to build a nest and capture bees at the nest entrance. So these groups of arthropods that I've mentioned are all minor arthropods. If you just keep your colony strong and healthy, control the things you can, nutrition stress, varroa, things like that, your bees will be perfectly okay losing a few members to these various groups of arthropods. Of course, you're going to see it. It might make you worried, but you can trust me to know that these are very unlikely to take down one of your colonies.